Welcome to our show. It's called That's So Chratheist. What is Chratheist? Well, it's a made-up word that consists of Christian and atheist, and it's the show that Christians and atheists can get along and have a reasonable and respectful discussion. My name is Truman A. Smith. I'm a former evangelical Christian. I was raised as a Roman Catholic. After college, I became a born-again evangelical Christian, and I remained one for about 25 years. I preached the gospel on local cable TV and also on the internet, and I founded a part-time 501c3 ministry for that purpose. In 2009, I left the faith and I became an atheist. In this show series, I try to find find Christians who are experts in science and or Christianity, and just have a respectful discussion with them. And I especially like to talk about the scientific issues because that's the reason why I left Christianity. So today my guest is Dennis Marcellino. Dennis, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Dennis is a professional musician as well as a prolific author. I'll list some of the books that you wrote here. How to Directly Experience God, Why Are We Here, Addiction Free Forever, The Solutions, and that's kind of like To All the World's Problems, kind of the longer title. And also The Plague of Liberalism.
And The Proof.
Oh, sorry, yeah, and is that your main one too? The main one is The Proof that God exists and the Bible is true.
Right.
So what else would you like to say about your books? I gave kind of a short title. I know you have longer subtitles too. Do you want to talk more about that?
Basically, I wrote these books because I was on a personal search for myself. To find out what the truth is and the best way to approach life. And I tried about 19 different things and ended up at the Bible as being the one that actually worked in satisfying my restless heart and giving me deep fulfillment.
Number 20 was good for you or
number
19?
Yeah, okay. Number 20.
Okay. I didn't know that was a godly number in the Bible or anything, is it?
Yeah, it might be.
777, I know, is some good numbers. Okay, so for today we're just going to have a general discussion. We'll see where it goes. I have some topics that I'd like to bring up, and did you have some topics that you'd like to talk about?
So sure.
We'll take some turns. And then our goal here is to not to have any sermons, but more of an interactive discussion, trying to give each other equal time. And we'll try to focus on the issue, and you know, I'm not going to try to say, like, well, here's something I believe, and I'll give you 10 reasons why, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you know, because then, you know, you can't respond to 10 things. So we'll try to narrow in, I guess, on things that we could actually dialogue about instead of talking past each other.
Okay.
So would you like to start with a question, or you want me to start?
Go ahead.
Okay.
It's your show.
And then what I'll do is I'll try to save time at the end where I'll try to give a minute summary of what I thought, how the show went, and Dennis will give I'll let him give a minute summary, and then I'll close with talking about where people can go to some other meetings if they're interested more in atheist and agnostic kind of events. If they're a Christian, it's easy to find out where Christians gather, so churches, and there's tons of them around. So atheists, it's not so easy. Okay, so I'll start with this. My last guest was Ted Davis, and he's an expert in historical science and religion interfacing. And basically, one of the things he says is that today in the modern times, there's this perceived science and religion conflict. And he says that's unfortunate and it's unnecessary. There shouldn't be a conflict. And part of that is that, you know, like, what could possibly be a conflict? Well, biological evolution. And I think he would say, well, there's nothing at odds with Christianity and biological evolution, for example. So I guess I wanted to get some of your viewpoint on that. Do you think there's a science and religion conflict?
Well, there's science points that people are making. I mean, you know, one of the main things is that, you know, people are really quick to pray to Jesus, but Jesus had a prayer, and his prayer was in John 17, 20, 23, that there'd be unity in his followers. So, you know, these are all just points of interest, but not theological debates shouldn't divide denominations and churches and Christians. So, yeah. I mean, so as far as the science conflict, yeah, there are different points of view. And like for me, I was always open to evolution as being a process that God could have used until I actually read Genesis, mm-hmm. You know. And if you actually read the literal reading of Genesis is that there is no possibility for evolution or for long time periods for things to come about.
Yeah, I think Ted would say that that's the problem, is that you shouldn't be reading it literally like that. You should consider its genre, and it's, you know, not meant to be teaching science. I mean, he would say something like that probably.
Well, there's a problem there because, I mean, that's been dug into very deeply. And what it comes down to is the word yom, and how the word yom is used in the Bible, in the Old Testament, and it means literal 24 hours a day. So to me, there is no, that would be the context. Because if you look at how is it used over 600 times in the Old Testament, it always means a literal 24 hours a day.
So I think your perspective is basically that there is a conflict with the Bible and modern science, but modern science is wrong when it comes to biological evolution, stating that humans evolved from other animals, right?
Right.
You know, from my perspective, you know, my take on the Bible is I would actually agree with you that the Bible was written and meant to be taken literally, but I think the problem is that there is a real conflict with modern science. And so we agree, I think, that it was literally written and it's supposed to say what it's trying to say. Only you reject evolution and I accept evolution. So, and that's one reason why I left the faith, too.
Right. Well, I mean, I don't see any evidence. I mean, when I look at all the data and all the evidence, I don't see any evidence for evolution. There's, you know, the missing links and everything, and the many hoaxes for, you know, for the missing links. And I see, you know, tons of evidence and proof, actually, that the Bible is true. So that's why, you know, for myself, my objective landing is on the Bible for a number of reasons, not just for science, so.
You know, because, you know, one thing I'm concerned about, too, because before I left Christianity, I was trying to adapt a theology that said, you know, we can deal with evolution. And one of the statements that comes out of there is basically, and there is this one theologian named Dennis Lamoureux, who is basically saying there is no Adam, just like there is no firmament, because in the Bible it talks about God created the firmament, you know, but that was ancient Hebrew science. And just as there's no firmament, there is no Adam and Eve, because evolution works over a long period of time in populations, and it's not like a human just popped out of an ape, you know, like, oh, here's the first human, here's the first woman, and now they're mating, and now here's the first humans. It's not like that. So it seems to me that it's a natural corollary that there is no Adam and Eve, and this is what some evangelicals are saying now. But for me, I couldn't maintain a faith with that. It's like, that's just stretching it too far.
That there's an Adam and Eve?
Yeah. Well, it's stretching it too far that trying to accept, I guess, evolution with Genesis, yeah.
Well, think of it this way. I mean, there's problems being presented from both sides, but how did male and female pop up at the same time? See, if something evolved, why would it split into male and female?
Yeah, and then, I mean, from the very earliest creatures, we have male and female. You know, we have sexual reproduction, and then all the descendants just kept that on.
Right. But why? Why would it split into male and female?
Well, from what I've read, there's some biological reasons for that. For one thing, it helps in the diversity of evolution because of the way it mixes up the genes. For example, if it's asexual reproduction, then you're basically making a clone. But when you're having sexual reproduction, you're having half the DNA of each male and female, and so it basically shuffles. And because of that, you can have it so it's more fit, more diverse, you know, so you can make more different versions more often. So.
So then how do you see an intelligence behind that? I mean, there has to obviously be some kind of intelligence programming what's going to happen there. I mean, why would something non-intelligent just do that on its own?
Well, I guess that's kind of, no, I would say there isn't really any intelligence. I mean, like one of the interesting things is, like some people say this is one of the signs of unintelligent design, actually. It's called the recurrent laryngeal nerve. Basically, there's this nerve that goes, I believe, from somewhere in the head around the brain area to the, I think, to the larynx to control speech, or not to speech, but to control swallowing, I think. Anyway, there's some kind of connection that it takes about 6 inches to do. And what happens is, in the fish, that's the way it is, but what happens is one of those cords, as the fish evolved into land animals and things, one of those cords got wrapped around the heart, and so, like, now that nerve, it goes all the way because it got trapped, it goes down around the heart and back up again. And so in giraffes, it's really wild because it goes down like, you know, 10 feet and back, you know, when it only had to go just a little bit. So it's like, why would somebody design that on purpose? But with evolution, it's just, it's obvious because it works, it's good enough, and it was just got caught in that kind of development. So, I mean, and then also when you look at evolution, it just fills all these niches, all these different varieties. Every niche has its own kind of plants and animals in it, so it's kind of like nature just kind of throwing things out to see what kind of sticks, it seems like. So I see that rather than intelligence, I guess.
Okay, well, do you want me to make my pitch for intelligence?
Sure.
Okay. Well, basically, nutshell proof that I have that God exists and that there's an intelligent, that he's an intelligent being, is that, first of all, I mean, we have to look and we have to see, yeah, definitely there is something more going on than humans, right? I mean, we're just on this little planet, there's a giant universe, so something more is going on than humans. So then it becomes a question of, well, what is that something more and where did this all come from? Okay, well, if you take two laws of thermodynamics, the second law of thermodynamics says that everything is wearing down. Mm-hmm. The energy, the inherent energy in the universe is being spent. So therefore, there had to be a beginning. Well, everybody kind of agrees on that, with that, you know. And then the next, the first law says that energy is neither created nor destroyed. So therefore, being that energy can't be created by something physical, see, that's where I get the jump here. It had to be created by something non-physical. And so then I would say, well, then what's the nature of that non-physical thing that started the physical universe? And I'd say that it's a powerful, intelligent, eternal being. And so it's powerful, obviously. There's a lot of power in the universe. It's intelligent, and then I get into that in detail in my book. Just one quick one. The birds flying in a V, you know, being coordinated. You know, how did that happen? How did that coordination happen? Well, there had to be an intelligence outside of the birds. If it was evolution, it would be an individual evolvement. But to have coordination amongst things that aren't connected, then that requires an intelligence. And what it boils down to is to program their DNA. It's because they don't have that ability. And then it had to be eternal, because there always had to be an eternally existing something, because there's nothing in nothing to be able to create something. So there had to always be. And so the logic of going against that would not work. And then it had to be a being, because something had to set it all in motion and plan the whole thing and then create the abilities for things to happen.
So you listed a whole bunch of things there we can talk about, I guess.
Okay, sorry. Well, you know, did you want to do that, or did you want to?
Well, we can. Let me just briefly talk about some of those, and then you can. Okay. We can go a little bit and see maybe if there's another topic. Did you have other things you wanted to talk about? Two different related things. Okay.
Sure.
So, on the second law of thermodynamics. So basically, one of the ways that's phrased is that things go from order to disorder as time progresses. So when you look at how a child grows from a baby to an adult, do you see that as a violation of the second law of thermodynamics? Because it's getting more complicated, like even the brain is being built and stuff.
Right. No, well, it's programmed on the DNA. That's why. It's just following its programming.
But is it violating thermodynamics?
No, because the DNA pre-existed.
But it's going from less ordered to more ordered.
Well, but the DNA is set up to create that. And that pre-existed, so mm-hmm. so the order was there before. How to organize molecules?
So I think the scientific answer is that, I mean, it's like asking gravity, is an airplane defying gravity by going up? Well, it's overcoming gravity because it's got another principle at work. So I think, like for example, a baby growing up, well, the second law of thermodynamics, that means a system overall. So you could have things going uphill in one part of it, whereas, like for example, if you're on a bicycle, it's possible to go uphill. Well, that's because if you're going down a hill and you pick up a lot of speed, then you can go uphill. So overall, you're losing energy and everything, but there is a certain part where you are going uphill. So just as the sun gives off all this huge amount of energy, so much of it is lost, but some of it is used on Earth, and we grow, but overall, most of it is lost. So I think that's why we can see little parts of that. violation. But the other thing too is this thing, whole thing about an open and closed system, because like personally I believe there's this multiverse theory where a bunch of universes are birthed and we're in one of them. And you know, according to that, there really is no such thing as a closed system. I mean, like scientists don't even know what's in a black hole. They don't know what's beyond the event horizon of a black hole. Sometimes I think, well, maybe these might be birthing other universes, or I mean, they have no idea.
Well, you just said, though, what you believe. See, so we want to keep belief and theory out of it if we can help it, if we're going to be scientific, right?
Well, my this is maybe where I have some difference of opinion with some of my fellow atheists. The way I view it is everybody has a fact base, and then from your fact base, you have to extrapolate and make guesses and stuff. And that's where you build your belief system. So I say beliefs should be built on the data. There's nothing wrong with beliefs if they're built on data.
The problem is
when beliefs are not built on data or go contrary to data. That's the problem.
No, I think there's a problem with belief. I have a thing that I call truth phobia, and phobia, where if you're going to really, you know, want to deal with truth, then you have to keep out. It's an acronym: feelings, opinions, beliefs, intellectualizing, and authorities. So that's truth phobia. And for me, I just like to deal with truth. And so, you know, why go off on tangents? See, I mean, there's a bottom line here for me, too. As far as, like I said, I was searched through 19 things before I hit the 20th one, and it worked. It works. You know, it gave me peace in my heart, deep fulfillment, clarity in my mind. My life worked. And whereas the 19 things I tried before didn't. So that, to me, is enough to, you know, to stick with Christianity. But of course, I do have a science background, and I did have to, you know, consider every question and unturn every stone, and it worked out for me. That's why I wrote the book, because it did work out.
Okay, well, maybe
intellectually.
How about if we focus in on this topic a little bit about beliefs, because I think there's a lot of discussion about that in the community, and like I said, I might have a different opinion than a lot of atheists, and in some ways, I see what you're doing is maybe even saying what some of the atheists might be saying. So let me give some examples, I guess. I mean, the way I see it, basically the way I see it is all knowledge comes down to how do you gain knowledge, and there's two primary sources, I think. One is induction and deduction. Induction is by observing the world. Like, for example, if all the swans you ever saw were white, you would say, I know that all swans are white. And if you ever saw a black one, you'd say, okay, now I know that's not true. But until that, you just say all swans are white. So that's an inductive truth. And then a deductive truth is where you might deduce things, kind of like Sherlock Holmes. It's, you know, he might say like, oh, here's a certain situation. You go, how do you know that? You must be like God to know that. And it's like, oh, because of this and that and this and that and this and that. I put it all together and this is what I deduced. So I think induction and deduction are the best ways to get to things. And then science, there's so much we don't know in science. Like, for example, they don't know what dark energy is and dark matter, and that makes most of the universe. You have to make theories, you have to make guesses, and try to find some ways to have a hypothesis, and then you test it and see if you can get feedback.
Sure, but I mean, deduction is the fun of science. It's the fun of life, you know. But there's enough inductive information to make life work. And so, you know, I think I like to limit myself to the inductive proofs.
But look at like the particle smasher, for example. They're looking for the Higgs boson. That's all kind of something that people deduce and tried to figure out as a theory. And then they build up they build this huge device, billion-dollar, you know, machine, particle collider. You know, I have no problem with using the word faith, on faith that they're going to find the answer.
Right.
When they did the Mars rover that just landed, you know, they had to have faith that it was going to land. You know, they did all their calculations and everything. But, you know, if they didn't have faith in it, they wouldn't have launched it probably. So it's like, you know, we're not going to launch this thing until we get all, you know, all the checks passed and everything. You know, and they're going to ask the people, are you sure it's ready? And they'll say, yeah. So.
Well, what you run into there, though, is you'll run into, okay, there's a Christian or a believing person on this side, you know, and then you have the supposed modern science on this side. And they can come up with all kinds of micro deductions, same on both sides. And that's kind of what we have in the world. You know, we have both of those going together. But for me personally, I just wanted to know, what is the truth? what can be proven? I mean, what does the best proof lie? And that it just, I mean, I didn't care where it was going to land. You know, it could have, I mean, I was in a lot of other different things. And, but it just happened to land on the Bible is true and it works and it can be proven so.
See, my personal opinion is, like you said, if you have a Christian, let's say an atheist, and they have different opinions, they'll say, I think this is the way the world is, this is my belief, and I have no problem with an atheist saying this is my belief. And so then what we should do is we should say, why do you believe that? And I think we should go down and talk about the details. For example, you talked about evolution. You mentioned there's a lot of hoaxes in there. So I would say, okay, let's talk about that, because I think there's misunderstandings there. And one thing you said before, because we've done, you know, other shows before, you said you had this hope or belief that if we talked enough, we'd probably come to the same conclusion or something.
No, we definitely would.
So that's kind of implying that we have a different knowledge base. And the more we talk, the more our knowledge base would equal out. Then we'll come to the same conclusions.
Well, no, I think the more we would, the Bible says iron sharpens iron, you know, and the more we would deal with each other's viewpoints, and the data backing them, and then we would say, oh, I see a problem there, and then you'd say, oh, yeah, well, you see a problem with me, and then I'd have to back it up, and you'd have to back it up, and eventually, you know, it may take years, but eventually we would agree, because there's only one truth. See, the science of logic says that there's only one truth. Mm-hmm. There's only one true explanation. Is there a God or isn't there a God? There's only one answer to that question. It's yes or no, see? So it's not a matter of belief or opinion, even though that's the way the world mostly operates.
See, I think for us, I mean, so basically, I think our different belief systems are built on different knowledge bases. So that's why I have no problem with belief. You know, if I want to challenge somebody's belief, I want to start working with, you know, asking them why they believe that and work with their knowledge base and then show them something else. I mean, there's a time when I didn't accept evolution, and I did accept evolution for scientific evidence, and so that's the thing I'd want to tell other people and, you know, see how that works with them.
Well, here's the what makes this important. It's that, you know, what kind of world are we handing over to our kids? You know, I mean, right now, marriage is very hard. There's a lot of divorces. People are very confused. There's a lot of depression, a lot of addiction, which I, you know, I have a program for and I deal with. And so, you know, that really has to do with, well, what deductions have we made? You know, as far as like how are human beings supposed to live? And you've kind of gotten into this topic before when you talk about good. You know, you say you're a good person, and I say I'm a good person. And then you've discussed, well, what's the basis for good? See, and then we might differ there. What I say for the basis for good is that just like if you get in a car.
Okay, so we're transitioning to a new topic now.
Yes.
Okay. What is good? Okay.
Okay. it's just like if you get in a car and, you know, I know somebody who put it in reverse while it was moving forward and had to buy a new transmission. So the car is designed to operate in a certain specific way. And so the result of that is you have a smooth ride if you operate it the way it was designed. Okay, well, this is the design too, this being, this body. And if we operate it correctly, then we get good feelings and not bad feelings. And there's harmony between us and other people and the world, as long as they're living in harmony. So there is an objective standard from a science standpoint.
Well, I wouldn't say that's objective. I would say that's kind of more consequentialist. It's the consequences of the actions. You have good consequences, and that's why you know it's good behavior.
Right, which are evidence of an inherent design. See, there's a pre-design that is creating the consequences. So it's just the good, you know, being good is recognizing, you know, when that is acting in harmony both within the being and with other beings and with nature itself.
Yeah, so I mean, yeah, but when you say it's absolute, so I think it's easy to prove it's not absolute. For example, people who think morality is absolute, they might say something like lying is wrong or lying is always bad. And it's like, no, sometimes lying is good. Like, for example, you know, if you're trying to hide Jews when Hitler's looking for them, there's nothing wrong with lying to save some lives. But, you know, a Christian might think, oh, it's always bad to lie. I have such a dilemma here. Should I lie or not, you know? And it's like, you shouldn't have to have a dilemma. It's not a difficult thing.
Right. Well, you're just talking about one aspect of morality. I'm just saying,
well, basically,
theoretically.
Well, I'm also saying it's situational.
Yeah. But I'm just saying, theoretically, there is an absolute, you know, as far as like, you know, what is good. Once again, there's only one truth. And so landing on that, those one truths, is what we try to do.
You know, here's my idea on this. I was kind of thinking about how to explain this. To me, I see what is good and what is bad is kind of like a map, or it's like following a path on a map. And if you want to go from A to B, what is good is the right thing to do to get there. So for example, if I want to have a good society, the good thing to do is something that's going to make that society flourish. And so how do you get from here to there? Well, I'm going to go kill everybody I don't like. No, that's not it. That's bad.
Right.
Oh, I'm going to be nice. I'll randomly be nice to people. Okay, that would be good. So you can see by what you do if you're getting to your target or not. So for me, it's heavily consequentialist.
Well, and then that's true. And so one of those consequences is, so being scientific, how can that be measured? Well, you measure it through social statistics. So the social statistics in this country have gone way down since God has been diminished in importance. And because I grew up in the 50s, so I know there was a lot more love and a lot more peace and a lot more safety then. The families were tighter, and people didn't lock their doors, they didn't lock their cars. That says something right there. You listen to the music, you know, which was an expression of people's hearts. The music was more peaceful, it was nice. And now there's a lot of anger in the popular music and everything. See, that's not working. So that's a way to determine good, too.
You know, yeah, I'm not sure. I mean, that'd be interesting. You'd have to, I think, show some data for that, because it'd be easy to get stuck with just feelings. Like, there's a lot of people who feel like, you know, there's a romantic view to the old days. I mean, the old days, things were so much better. That's kind of a general human tendency.
They were.
So,
well, that's why I'm saying, though, one way to take out the romanticizing of that is go with the social statistics. And I've got plenty of that in my books, you know, where I chronicle it. As far as, you know, like today, the teen suicide rate is bigger than all 26 industrialized nations combined, you know, or, you know, so that there's a lot of things. And like I said, that's a statistical way of evaluating this. The other way is by going by the expressions of people's hearts, the music, the television, the movies. And then I lived there. I lived during that time, and I know it was totally safe. So, you know, crime rates, that would be another, you know, way to determine that safety. But I know not only was it safe, but where there's order, there's peace. See, in the Bible gives an order, you know, as to how we should behave. And so there's peace, and there's love, and there's joy. And I know that there was a lot more of those things back in those days.
What do you think about, for example, in the Old Testament, it talks about, you know, when we talk about good and bad?
I know where you're going.
Okay, I don't know if you heard this one before or not, but okay. In there it talks about, like, if the man finds out on his wedding night that the woman is not a virgin, that you are to stone her, kill her.
Well,
you heard that one?
Yeah, they held to a higher standard back then. So, therefore...
Higher or lower?
No, I'd say higher, because... See, the thing is that, okay, let's talk about marriage and virginity and all that.
Yeah.
If two virgins get married and they stay together for life, you know how much love comes out of that? I mean, love towards each other, love towards their children, safety, you know.
I would think it depends on their personality, because whether they're a virgin or not might have less to do than if they're an introvert or extrovert, or how they were raised, and... There's probably a lot of other factors.
Well,
too.
How they were raised by the Bible. See, if they were raised by the Bible, I mean, that, I just know from also personal experience in marriage and stuff. I got married when I was 17, and I got married in a pre-hippie era, basically, before things started going downhill as far as morals go. And we were just so in love. I mean, you don't even have to question it. You can just you feel totally safe with that person. You just totally feel totally in love. Mm-hmm. Now, ever since then, there's been like this enmity between males and females, you know, fostered by the media. And so now people are wary of each other, see, and then they have to use alcohol, you know, and drugs to have sex. And, you know, and then talking about good and bad, okay, what's nature's feedback? Okay, nature's feedback is STDs, AIDS, for people, you know, in a monogamous marriage, a virgin, those things don't exist at all. So,
but you're actually saying it's a superior moral law to stone a woman if she's not a virgin?
Well, I mean, we can find out where that line is. Everybody has a line, capital punishment, imprisonment, parole, let him go. So where is your line? See, where would you draw the line? And so for the greater good, to hold the standard in society that do not, give up your virginity.
Yeah, but I don't see how you could even support killing somebody for that reason.
Well, I mean, like I said, then, okay, do you accept capital punishment for anything?
I haven't really thought about it a whole bunch. I would say I would probably consider it for like a mass murder stuff. I think, prison, there's a controversy whether prison should be a penalty or a rehabilitation kind of aspect to it. And sometimes prisons are so much in the punitive, they don't want to rehabilitate. So, I mean, I think we should try to rehabilitate people, but maybe if they're a mass murderer or somebody really bad, maybe they should be executed. So, but a woman who's not a virgin, I mean, I would say that doesn't even come close. I mean, no way. I mean,
well,
that's not even.
In those days, though, they had such a high standard, and maybe they had a higher quality of living. I'm saying when those standards were more the standards of this country, there was a higher quality of living, especially love and the bonding between males and females. And so that's by getting loose on the standard, that's what you lose.
Well, I think that their morality was actually more immature than us. For example, them tolerating slavery. I think slavery is immoral.
Well, yeah, as far as owning, but slavery is the word slavery. I mean, and slave in the Bible is different. It's more like employer, employee.
but they're not free though. I mean, they're basically property of the owner. So they're not free to leave if they don't want to.
Yeah, I wonder what that really is, though. I don't. I think no. There are conditions. You can work your way out of slavery, in the Bible. So It's not like an ownership thing.
Well, like here in America, slavery is outlawed, and if you think, my boss is treating me like a slave, I'll just quit and go somewhere else. But they couldn't do that.
Right. Well, even the Bible, though, talks about Christians being slaves to Christ. I like that. I like that. I mean, it's like it frees me. First of all, I have total respect for him. Mm-hmm. But it frees me to not have to take my allegiance elsewhere. And in the case of, a slave employer-employee situation, you don't have to worry about your living.
But you do have a choice still to leave if you want to. Like, I also considered myself a slave of Christ when I was a Christian, and I left. I was able to leave. So.
Well, they could leave, I mean, in the Bible days.
I don't think so.
Yeah, we have to do a little study on that.
Okay, so what other topic did you have you wanted to talk about?
Okay, you said your two reasons for leaving Christianity was evolution. Mm-hmm. And also that we're not a spirit.
Right.
Okay. So in our last debate, I showed a movie of a woman who was blind from birth.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden she died from a car accident and her spirit left her body and she was able to see. She had no concept of black or white or shadows. I mean, she couldn't see anything. When she dreamed, she didn't see anything. But then when she had this experience, she was able to see color. She had no concept of color, and she was able to report all these things mm-hmm. when she came back. Well, and that movie's on the web. Vicky Noratuk is her name, Noratuk. There are many situations like that, and they're all chronicled in a book called Mind Sights. So that tells me, people leave their body, they go somewhere, and they hear a conversation. They're able to come back and report what they heard.
Well, for me, I didn't really listen to it that closely because I don't take it seriously. I mean, to me, it's just like a ghost story. You can hear all kinds of ghost stories, and you don't take them seriously. Especially, I mean, like you could hear a Mormon tell you a ghost story about or a Muslim or somebody. And you
but
may that, not,
that's a little more scientific. What you're talking about is hearsay. You know, what I just described was scientific.
I don't think it was scientific. I think it's also hearsay.
If somebody goes and they're blind from birth, mm-hmm. and they go and they can... describe color, which it's something they never saw before. They can describe conversations that happened far away, That's not hearsay, and especially when it's done over and over. Many races, many religions, many nationalities. This is a constant thing.
Well, you're also just telling the story that somebody wanted to tell you too. So they could be fixing up the way they want to hear it. Because I mean, one thing I always remember is when I was a Christian. I think I told you this. We had a group of people, and we were all kind of experimenting around with spirituality and stuff, and getting messages from God and things. And one woman talked about how she had this experience with these demons squelching and through the church and all this stuff. And then the next Sunday, I heard the pastor telling the story. And at first, I thought, okay, that's the story I heard. And then it was just like getting, the details were so flowery and different. It's like, oh, that's got to be a different story. Then I thought, wait a minute, it's got to be the same story. How many similar stories can you have like that? So it's like, I really didn't even recognize it. And I was there when she told the story to both of us.
Yeah.
So I think he was just, you know, embellishing it big
that's
time.
True.
So it's like.
Yeah, there's all kinds of embellishing going on.
So, I mean, that's
well, people.
You know, and I'll tell you myself, I had some really amazing dreams that I thought could have been from God. And I had the choice when I wanted to retell those dreams, whether I wanted to tell them as dirty as they were, because they have some other artifacts in there that don't make any sense. So they're kind of like a dirty dream as far as they're not very clean, as far as nice and crisp. So a bunch of other garbage in there. So if I want to tell a cleaner version of it that was really brilliant, I can take away all that other stuff and say like, oh, let me tell you about my dream and just tell you the polished version of it. You know, so.
Well, the truth is the truth. Like I said, there's only one truth. And we have to wade through all these, you know, beliefs, opinions, embellished accounts. Yeah, we have to wade through all that in life. And come up with, well, what's true, and let's just accept whatever is true. And so I feel what I've done here.
And there's some scientists who are actually studying out-of-body experiences. Like there's a certain operating table where they routinely like stop their heart, maybe for a heart transplant or something like that. And they have these tiles up above that only the person could see if they went up there because they're blocked by lights or something. And they're constantly switching, so they're looking for people who said they had an out-of-body experience. You know, they can say like, oh, what did you see up there? And even the doctors don't know what's there, so it's a double-blind test. And they've been doing this for years, and they haven't got any results out of it.
Well, that doesn't negate the results, though. that doesn't negate all the actual stories of people who've done that. So that's kind of like, you know, glass half empty, glass half full.
So for me, that's I just think of it as hearsay, like any other ghost story.
You can't write off all the data, though, as hearsay.
Well, I don't really see it as data, though. I see it as storytelling.
Okay, well, read the book Mind Sites. You know, maybe that'll. Maybe we should drop this subject at that point.
Yeah, you know, because you know what's interesting is when you brought that up, it's not compelling to me at all, but I've heard some other, I think it was Gary Habermas who was actually talking about the resurrection. He was trying to bring up out-of-body experiences as evidence. I thought, oh, okay, so there's more than one person talking about this. So it's interesting. So. What was it called? Mind what?
Mind sights.
I did a long time ago read a book called Life After Death. Life After Life, yeah. That was really popular. Years ago.
Well, you know, there's a lot of things out there too. As you get into researching this, I mean, there's a lot of people, they want to believe a certain thing. So they'll just be very selective about what they read, what they hear. Just whatever will bolster their worldview and or the conclusion that they've come to, in the case of Christianity, just because it feels good, Jesus is this good guy, he feels good, he's got a good plan, so why not identify with him? But they don't take it intellectually to the nth degree, you know. That's why they need people like us.
Well, let me ask you a different question. Can we move on to another topic?
Yeah, sure.
I wonder what your thinking is on, we might possibly, right now we don't know who's the president of the USA in the next election, okay? So right now it's looking like Romney versus Obama. And Romney is a Mormon, and I guess he used to be a high leader in his church. I don't know if you know that or not. He was like a bishop or something. He was a stake person, president or something. I don't know. He was really high up there. So... one thing I'm thinking is it kind of scares me that somebody, you know, for the commander-in-chief, for the America is the most strongest nation on earth. We have the most influence. Do we want to have somebody in there that cannot think critically? And when it comes to Mormonism, if you look at that faith, it seems like it's the easiest thing to debunk because it's kind of newer. But one of the major things is that Joseph Smith claimed that to translate this book. It's called The Book of Abraham. And it turned out that nobody could read Egyptian at that time. And so he got away with saying, this is the Book of Abraham. And now people can read Egyptian. And they say, no, that's called the Book of Breathings. It's an Egyptian funeral text. So Joseph Smith got caught lying. And so this whole faith is built upon a lying prophet. And so, you know, the most important thing to you is probably your belief. And, you know, if you can't critically examine that when it's easy to disallow, how else can you make other decisions, like on the economy, on should we bomb Iran or North Korea or defend Israel? I mean, all these things, you really want to have somebody that can think critically and not just...
Well, okay, I don't know if he's lock, stock, and barrel on Mormonism, but, you know, this goes back to what I was saying earlier about Jesus saying we should have unity. You know, the bottom line is having faith in Jesus and the Bible. That's the bottom line. And, yes, that's a religion. And to me, it's the truth, though. All this other we're not trying to elect a theologian in chief, you know. We're trying to elect somebody who can greatly do the job of a president, you know, which we have a real bad one now. Statistically, we can show that. So we need somebody, and Romney's got a great record in economics. So that's what we really want. We want somebody who's sufficient economically and has a plan to help the country in the job they're in. I mean, they keep saying, okay, Obama's a nice family man. Well, I'm sure you're a nice family man, too. But would you say that would qualify you to be president, you know, as far as, like, running an economic system? So therefore, you know, it's a mess out there politically, to me. But what it comes down to is president is a job. And what we want is somebody who can do the job well. And, you know, right now we have a bunch of sound bites flying at each other, you know, attack ads. And it's really unfortunate. But I think Romney would do a way better job.
But, you know, to some extent, I mean, you know, in America we don't like to talk about religion. They say we should keep religion out of it and things. But, you know, if this person came forward and said, I believe in Zeus, you know, some ancient mythology, obviously you would say, well, there's a problem there because he believes in that. Or what if he believed in astrology? He believed in reading the stars for his future.
Well, okay.
We would say, whoa. Or okay. What if he believed in a flat earth? We would say, whoa.
Yeah, well, those are extremes, but
why isn't Mormonism extreme too? I mean, it's so easy to debunk.
Well, because like once I said, the theological backs and forths aren't important. But you know, I mean, what it comes down to is that secular humanism is a religion too. I mean, it's defined in the dictionary as a religion. And what is a religion? Basically, has two things. A religion defines morals. And it defines existence. Okay, so the morals of a secular humanist basically are political correctness. And so, you have Obama in this position. And then existence is defined by science, you know, supposed modern science. So I would like somebody in office who would devoid themselves of those things, you know, who would just be, how am I going to be a good president? What is the job requirement? And can I do it well? And that's what I would want in a president.
Okay, but you know, like I said before, though, the religion is your most personal thing. You know, it's the most important thing in your life, especially when, you know, if there's eternal stakes, you know, you have to believe this and you go into heaven or this or you go to hell or something.
Well, but see, then what it comes down to again is that, so therefore, secular humanism is a bad religion because of the social statistics and the entertainment, the expressions of the hearts of people that I said before. So therefore, I would not want a secular humanist in the presidency because that's a bad religion, because it produces bad consequences.
Do you think Obama's a secular humanist?
Yes.
You don't think he claims to be a Christian?
I know, but he doesn't go to church. I mean, and the churches he did go into before were kind of wacko. And he kind of is the type that, you know, there's the shepherds and the sheep. So he's kind of been a sheep in terms of religion. And the shepherds he's latched onto, you know, like Reverend Wright, have not been very
okay,
good.
Okay, so if I would say there's a huge problem in having a Mormon as a president because Mormonism is so easy to falsify. You might say, well, it's the same thing of having a secular humanist as president because it's easy to falsify?
No, I would say that Romney would have to be able to devoid himself of Mormonism as far as an expression of how he's going to run the office. Secular humanists don't do that. They actually try to mold the country into their morals, and their exclusion of God in the evolution thing. So, yeah, I would want just somebody who, you know, what is a president supposed to do, and who can do that job well?
Well, I think ultimately everybody who's a president is going to try to mold the country with their moral outlook. I mean, because that's what they believe. So that's reasonable to expect that to happen.
But there's not necessarily. There's a moral outlook, but there's the economic outlook too. And you know, there's the checks and balances. There's a Congress, and there's the Supreme Court. You know, and there's the whole court system. So I don't think anybody could really get away with really changing the country completely without the feedback coming, because they're up for election again.
Well, so do you agree with me that Mormonism is easy to debunk? Like, do you know about the Book of Abraham thing?
No, you're the ex-Mormon.
I'm not an ex-Mormon, but I studied Mormonism a lot.
Oh, I thought you said you were Mormon.
No, but I studied Mormonism. No.
Oh, no,
I'm an ex-evangelical Christian, like you.
Oh, good. Yeah, I'm not ex. No. Yeah, oh, yeah, yeah. Let me see. Yeah, no, I don't know Mormonism well. But the thing is that, like I said, there's the basic, you know, I love the Bible. I love I love God. I follow that. And that should be common amongst all the denominations. All that other stuff is theological. You know, and yeah, there are some people who have run with some weirdness, like the Mormons with the diapers and all that stuff. But
I mean, I don't know about diapers. I mean, the underwear stuff.
Oh, I heard diapers. Yeah, but anyway, no. I mean, I don't know. I'm not speaking.
They have special undergarments to protect them from evil spirits.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so, you know, so there's some weird stuff going on in all religions, though. You know, in all denominations.
Really? What's weird in your religion?
Let's see. What's weird in my religion? Ooh, yeah. We'll talk about that some other time.
Okay. Self-disclosure. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, how much time do we have, by the way?
Just about 10 minutes.
Okay. There's one I wanted to get to.
Okay. But one thing I just wanted to say, though, is that you said it shouldn't be a theological thing. Well, my concern is that there's a fatal flaw in his critical thinking when, you know, exactly.
Well, how much
him,
do you know that he's buying into that stuff, though?
Well, from...
I mean, still, right
well,
now.
Well, it's kind of... It seems like he covered his tracks as far as there's not... If you look on the news and Google it, it's hard to find any information. But
I mean, if you compare it to Obama, it's just like, it's horrible on Obama's side.
Well, as far as theology, I mean, Romney was what they call... He's high up. He was like... I can't remember what they call it, the stake president or something, but...
But
Bishop
he's not
going to
have the Congress wearing protective underwear. So he's not going to go.
No, but my concern is that it's so easy to debunk it. Because, see, what happens is there is a facsimile in the Book of Abraham. It shows a picture, and it shows, like, this altar with some Egyptian characters. And he goes, here's the translation. Abraham says blah, blah, blah. And it's like, no, that's not what it says.
You're right.
Well,
I could find problems in every denomination, actually.
Not like that, though. I mean, this proves he was a liar when he says he's a prophet. Translating. This is not a translation.
Well, that's it. No, that's true. But, you know, I mean, how long does it take somebody to really find out what the truth is? And, you know, I mean, yeah, like
well, being
like
a Mormon,
I said,
though, he should know even more because, I mean, he should investigate his own beliefs.
Maybe he does. I mean, we're talking hypothetically because we don't know what he believes, really, and how strongly he believes in those things. So, and how much he would drag him into the presidency, whereas Obama has dragged some bad economic policies into the presidency that's hurt this country.
See, most people don't want to talk about this, but I really think it's fascinating because,
because
I talked to Mormon missionaries before, and the way I see it is they want to keep low, and you know, a lot of times they'll just refer people to the website or something. And one time in debates, I tried to get some Mormons, you know, in, and they're like, well, we can't do anything. It's like, well, we're going to talk about Mormonism, and they'll say, well, say what you want. Well, our missionaries basically do the mop-up, you know? And I found out they don't even have a seminary. They don't even teach, like, professional Mormons or anything.
That's true in most religions. So the formation, the Christian formation is really, really bad in this country, in all denominations, pretty much. That's why I write the books. So
But they have seminaries, though. I mean, like Catholics and Baptists and all
I know,
Baptists
but they don't come
that.
Out... They don't come out too good. So, I mean, they don't come out really solid. So that's why I do what I do.
I found out the Mormon seminaries are really just to teach high school kids during the, like, release time and stuff.
Right,
and
when they go out and do their missions.
So, anyway.
Yeah, there's two things I wanted to get to.
Okay, let's
one evolutionary and one personal.
Okay.
I just out of my own curiosity, if after you die it turns out that there is a God, what are you going to say to him as to why he should let you in heaven? And how comfortable are you risking that encounter with God going very badly because of your stance against him now?
Well, the way I received that question is kind of like, what if I said to you, Dennis, what if it turns out there's really an Easter bunny? I mean, you're thinking, how could it possibly be? I mean, that's how I'm thinking.
Okay, I understand. That's how you're thinking. Nevertheless, this is, we'll go on to part two of the question.
Well, so basically,
how comfortable are you in that conclusion, comparing God to an Easter bunny?
Yeah, 100% comfortable. I mean, to me, God is exactly like Santa Claus. They're both fictional characters. Okay. See, I don't think Jesus is in heaven, just like Santa's not at the North Pole. Same exact thing.
Okay,
but
see, you got to go to bed at night, and you got to rest your head in the pillow, and you got to let things float.
Right.
That's okay. I'm just curious. I just wanted to hear it.
But you know, let me talk a little bit more about that. See, now this thing too about if I went and saw God, you know, I thought about with what I know in science and stuff. Let me reformulate. What would God be? You know, I don't know. You could.
No, there's going to be a moment of truth though on that. You're going to die, and then something's going to happen, or nothing's going to happen, and you're gambling your life and your eternity on your decision that whatever you choose.
Right.
So I just wanted to see how, I couldn't be comfortable with that, but I just wanted to see how comfortable you are with that.
Yeah, I'm very comfortable with it. Okay. I don't see as much as a gamble, really.
Okay. Okay, my other point is evolution point. And I've made this one before, and I've never heard anybody else make this point. If the impetus of physicality is to evolve, why don't we see any evolution on any other planet which have the same molecular base as Earth, in spite of the fact that Earth is tremendously advanced and diverse in molecular manifestation?
Mm-hmm. Well, the reason why is because we can't really even see. They're trying to find, they call them exoplanets.
Yeah. No, let's stick to the solar system. We can't see this solar system.
Right, right.
Why isn't there any, as diverse and magnificent as this planet is in molecular diversity,
right,
why don't we see just an inkling of evolution,
right,
if the impetus of physicality is to evolve?
Well, I don't know if the impetus is to evolve, but it does seem like there is what I would call a forward bias towards life and living. I mean, it's kind of like the way I look at it is like when you have an automatic transmission and you have a car, you come up to a stoplight, right? You have to put your foot on the brake, otherwise it's going to go forward. When you take your foot off, the resting position is actually to go forward.
Well, why isn't any other planet going forward?
Well, because there's a habitable zone in our solar system, and so we're in the habitable zone.
Well, okay.
And they may find life on Mars and other things.
Okay, what I say to that, the habitable zone, the ideal circumstances here, is I say, okay, we're a spirit in a body. Well, if we're a spirit, then we could have just a different body. It'll be habitable to that planet. See, it would be able to, you know, just like the rest of the planet is existing with its dust and its dirt and its molecules and its amino acids and all that, you know. So that's why I don't buy the whole habitable thing. I mean, that's a very popular argument even in Christianity.
Well, I think you should consider this, though, too. You know, we're in the Milky Way galaxy, and I think there's like 200,000 stars, I think, in the Milky Way galaxy.
Well, I've heard more about
that. It's like 200 billion or something. 100 billion, maybe?
100 million.
No,
billion. Yeah,
there's like 100 billion, I think. And so that's just in our galaxy. And then there's like, there's supposed to be like same amount of galaxies, like 200 billion galaxies or something.
Right.
And, you know, we can't even see the farthest one out because light can't get that far out. So I think it's very likely there's lots of life out there, but we're too far away to see each other. And that's why they're searching for these exoplanets. They found like 80 of them or something that are potential candidates.
Right.
But they're so far away.
But see, back to the resting your head on the pillow at night thing.
Mm-hmm.
You're gambling your life on a theory, on a possibility, on a hypothetical thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, why go there? I mean, that I'd say that even for evolution. Why accept evolution when there's no proof for it? There's no missing links. What's happening is that people create this alternate viewpoint of life and a physicality in existence. Why create that when there's all this proof, and I have a chapter in there on sociology and psychology, and it's proven to be effective psychologically and sociologically. Why reject that for something hypothetical?
Well, the way I see it is the evidence for evolution is so strong that I can't deny it for biological evolution. And like the one thing is a pseudogene argument. When you look at how genes, the bits change through different species, to me, it's obvious.
Okay. I mean, I see the arguments against it are being very strong.
But most of the biologists would say, the majority of biologists would accept it, and you might think they're
deceived. That doesn't make it right.
But they're the experts in the field.
The majority of Germans during World War II backed Hitler. That didn't make him right.
But see, like, you know, for example, you're an expert saxophone player, right? And I don't know how to play it. So, I mean, if I had my theories about saxophone players and all that stuff, my opinion wouldn't be worth anything compared to yours because you're an expert in it. So when you look at the experts in biology, almost all of them don't have any problem with
that. Well, no, there's a lot of top ones, even Nobel Prize winners, who go along with God and the Bible.
But in biology, though, they don't go against...
What's the genome guy? Collins.
Francis Collins, right? Yeah, but he accepts evolution, though, for example.
I didn't know that.
He wrote the book, The Language of God, and he in there he gives evidence for evolution, but he just says there's no problem with evolution in theology.
Well, there is. I mean, it's like he's not a very good Bible reader then, because it's... I mean, like I said, I accept that evolution, too, until I actually read Genesis. It's very clear. You know,
well, see, my opinion of Francis Collins is he's just saying, as a scientist, I can tell you evolution's true, there's no problem with the Bible. Then if you say, well, how do you work it all out? He goes, oh, that's the work of a theologian. You know, he tries to pass it off to other people.
Well, that's good. Well, that's honest. That's honest. That's good.
So, was there another question you wanted to ask me? Because otherwise we should close out the show.
Yeah, I think I covered it all.
Okay, so let me give... about a minute or so closing. I'll give you a minute or so closing. I'll take less than a minute. So basically, I just want to say, I guess, me and Dennis, we know each other well. We've talked many times. We've done many debates. I really think that one thing I appreciate about you is you really believe what you believe, you know, like me, and you're able to talk about it, because I've met some people who... they're not interested in dialogue, and they want to try to slant the conversation and pull out tricks and stuff like that. So,
right.
So, you know, and like I said, you said before that if we talked enough, we might come to a common conclusion. I like that about you, and I think the same thing. It shows hope for humanity, I think.
Because we only want the truth. That's our standard.
Yeah, and you know, maybe one of the major differences we have is evolution, where I accept biological evolution and you reject it. You know. And those are good things to talk about, I think.
Yeah, so. And I don't reject or accept anything that I'm not absolutely sure about. Oh, I'm sorry, this is your minute.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't really have much more to say. I think a lot of your arguments are God of the Gap type arguments. It's like, oh, we don't know this, therefore that's evidence for God. So I just throw out a lot of your arguments kind of categorically like that. So.
Yeah, well, that's why I have my proof. I mean, you have to, that's why I said the powerful, intelligent, eternal being and the first and second law of thermodynamics. I think it's a very well-reasoned conclusion to come to about God. You know, and then there's the Bible. The Bible works. So you put all that together, and I can't see a better way to approach life.
Okay, is there anything else you want to throw in for a summary?
No, I think we've covered it all.
Okay, so... like I said, if you're an atheist or agnostic, it might be hard to find where others are meeting. So one really good place is to go to meetup.com. In meetup.com, you can put any kind of activity in there and find like-minded people. So if you put in atheist, you'll see a bunch of things pop up. One is Humanists of Greater Portland. Another one is CFI, the Center for Inquiry. They have a Portland chapter. They have a group called the Flying Spaghetti Monster Lands for a Pint. And then for me, Truman Smith, you can find me on my webpage at trumansmith.com. And Dennis, tell them how to get a hold of you for more information.
Dennis Marcellino Ministries.org. That's kind of like a shell that has all my stuff. You know, one thing I'd like to say, too, is that the church I go to is really good. I mean, you know, there are different qualities of churches, and the one that I go to is called Willamette Christian Church.
Yeah. Well, thanks, Dennis, for being on the show.
Thank you.
And thank you guys for tuning in, and we'll see you next time.